Well, earlier we'd reported on Iran condemning the Saudi foreign minister's latest accusations against the Islamic Republic. As Adel Al-Jubeir said, Iran is a source of terrorism in the Middle East and accused Tehran of intervening in the internal affairs of regional countries. Let's speak to Alexander Azadgan. He's a professor and editor at large with ImperiaNews.com, and he joins us via Skype from Laguna Beach. Many thanks for joining us here on Press TV, Professor Azadgan. Now, first of all, this is not the first time that Saudi Arabia has accused Iran of terrorism and meddling in the internal affairs of regional countries. What do you say to that? Is there any weight to these claims?
Thank you, Kenny's, for your invitation. It's always good to be with Press TV. Yes, there is weight. We should take anything, any threats from Saudi Arabia in times like this very seriously. We just heard that the Saudis opened their airspace to Israel, so they're not even hiding their alliance with Israel anymore. It's going to be public very shortly, I think, after the coming into power of this thug, Mohammed bin Salman. In psychology, the behavior that Saudi Arabia is exhibiting, we simply call it projection. Saudi Arabia is projecting its own failed policies in the Middle East, accusations of terrorism, and all sorts of ills that it has been implementing really since the 1960s, according to a political article that was written not too long ago by Khalil Zalmay. I forgot his last name. He was the UN ambassador, the US ambassador in Afghanistan and then Iraq, and now I think he's working for the Saudi lobby. But the Saudis sort of confessed to him that they've been behind every terrorist organization and attack really in the Middle East since the coming into power of Kamal Nasser, which they were really petrified of. So that trend is continuing now. And this so-called new prince is very aggressive, he's very Iranophobic, and he likes to blame everything on the Iranian Revolution of 1979. His advisors have told him not to mention that. He just says the post-1979 world in the Middle East. So we should expect more of this, especially with the selection of a real right-wing blowhard, neocon blowhard like Michael Bolton, into such a lofty place within the Trump administration. We cannot take these claims lightly.
Right, that does bring me to my next question, Professor Azadgan. Is that on the way the Trump administration has been perceiving the Saudi regime right now, specifically with the new arms trade deals, etc., where that cozy relationship between the U.S. and Saudi Arabia has gone a step further, according to many? Do you think this is also giving a green light to Saudi Arabia to continue with its policies in the region, be it exporting Takfiri ideology, supporting terrorist groups within the Middle East and the region beyond, and its war in Yemen, for example?
It's giving Saudi Arabia multiple green lights on many fronts. They clearly lost in Syria. They followed the suit of Qatar. They came out of this conflict, even though they are really lusting to get back in there. In Yemen, there's no relenting. It's going to go on, I'm afraid, for a while. Nobody's paying attention at the UN level to that. Over around 14,000 or more Yemenis being killed. So Mr. Trump gave the green light to the Saudis a long time ago. And symbolically, the first country that he visited when he became president of Saudi Arabia. Usually the tradition is in the U.S. presidency that they usually visit the U.K. He visited Saudi Arabia to diss the Iranians. They're sending every signal possible to the Iranians. And again, with the coming into power of this neocon, John Bolton, who's a warmonger, who's a war criminal, who's a signatory to the Project for a New American Century, PNAC, which was the think tank behind 9/11. They're sending every signal to Iran to sort of isolate Iran, which is they can take that dream to the grave, actually, because China and Russia are behind Iran, especially Russia. Russia's getting persecuted by the U.S., so no matter how many green lights they give to Saudi Arabia, Saudi Arabia's policies have been failing in the past several years. That we can go to 2011 since they started this mess in Syria. And I think personally, these are all signs of weakness. They have all sorts of internal problems, Kenny's, within their kingdom, their so-called kingdom. And the youth over there are very restless. And I don't think the coming into power of Mohammed bin Salman is any compromise to the restless youth of Saudi Arabia. Mohammed bin Salman coming to Washington in March, actually, we predicted about a year ago, my company, that he was basically getting, trying to get the Washington consent to get rid of his father. Looks like that plan has been sort of delayed for the time being, but once this criminal gets into power, we're going to see all sorts of unpredictable behavior by him, because that's how he likes to project himself. So Mr. Trump certainly has a lot on his hands, and a lot of wrong decisions are to be made, I'm afraid, with the coming into power of John Bolton. And I'm afraid, I'm quite concerned that Iran and North Korea could be part of these wrong decisions that they're going to make at Washington in the months to come.
Right now, this combined U.S.-Saudi policy when it comes to Iran specifically, it seems that Iran is being made the scapegoat as well, be it for whatever reason within the Middle East, it's always blamed on Iran. Do you think this is also going to then unfold into something larger? You mentioned the nuclear deal, but a bigger confrontation where the U.S. props up Saudi Arabia against Iran. Iran has time and again said that it doesn't want to do that. It wants to work with its neighbors.
Iran has been sending so many reconciliatory messages and signals to Saudi Arabia. Dr. Zarif himself is on record telling the world that he once called Al Jubeir or somebody else within the Saudi power structure, and they dissed him so undiplomatically and told him this is an Arab affair and that you have nothing to do with it. So I think the Saudis are misconceiving Iran's role. Iran may have some internal issues just like any country does, but Iran's star has been rising, I would say, since 2003, since that horrible decision by President Bush to invade Iraq. So the fact that Iran and Iraq are allies, two countries that were set against each other in the 1980s to kill each other off and to basically neutralize each other, are now very strong allies, not to mention Syria, Lebanon, and quite possibly Yemen. So I think the Saudis should acknowledge that Iran is a civilization that has been around for 7,000 years, whereas their country is not even 100 years old. So I think their arrogance and pride is getting in the way of clear diplomatic thinking. Saudi Arabia does not get to declare what Persia gets to do. This is a much older, much more powerful civilization than they are. So I think their hubris is their Achilles heel. Also, they want to blame everything on Iran. I mean, it's ridiculous. Everybody's laughing. The Russians are laughing, Indians, certainly Chinese, and the rest of the developing world. So I see these as desperate signs by Saudi Arabia to blame its own policies internally and externally and just assign blame to a country that has been a force for good. Iran has been on the right side of history. So some acknowledgement by them would be helpful.
Okay, let's leave it there for now. That's Alexandra Zadkan, professor and editor-at-large at imperialnews.com, joining us via Skype from Laguna Beach. Professor Zadkan, thank you very much indeed for your comments here on Press TV.